Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming. I'm John Crum. Today, we give a warm welcome to Scott Davidoff from JPL, hosted by AJ and me. And AJ and I first got to know Scott when he was a PhD student at CMU. And now he manages the, the Human Interfaces Group at NASA JPL. And when I told Scott that today was our Halloween party, so he threatened to come in costume. But he didn't. So I was expecting, expecting in order, astronaut, alien, robot, or maybe Mohawk guy. So, but he's regular. And then Scott was kind enough to bring along his colleague Mark Powell, who is Curiosity Rover Flight Software Technical Lead. And so he's going to be doing part of this talk too. Okay, so take it away.
Thank you very much. So this image is clearly one of the icons of a generation, and I think really helped define how we see our relationship to our universe. And what I'd like to talk about today is how, and this footprint had a face to it. And, you know, it's truly a human mark. But our mark of exploration today is looking a little bit different. And the tracks that we're leaving on other planets no longer have a human shape. And this creates a very interesting set of issues for our exploration. And rather than a human face, we have this cute feller here, and you know, she's really the hero of the exploration, and our entire window into the other world comes through her senses, and everything that she does comes from our command. But the difference now is that there's 80 million miles between us. And so the set of problems for exploration are a little bit different. And at JPL, in the Human Interfaces Group, our sets of what we do involves both the uplink side to the robots and the downlink side. So the uplink side actually starts with a very social problem, which is to develop a system to allow the 300 Mars scientists who are now gathered at JPL to come to some kind of agreement every day so that they can come up with a plan for what the robot should do. Some would say that getting scientists to agree is the hardest of all of the problems. And then we have to take the goals that all of the scientists provide for us and actually balance them with what we know the rover can do, how much power it has, whether the cameras would accidentally focus on the sun, how long the day is. Make sure that these are all, in fact, valid, and then turn this into a plan and radiate it through here. This is an image of the 70-meter dish at Goldstone. Then on the downlink side, what we get are just loads and loads of data. So we get all the telemetry, the images, the state of the robot, and then, of course, turn them into subsequent products like 3D images. And we really want to be able to have a very accurate model of what the state of the spacecraft is and where it is in its environment. Make sure everything's healthy, and then part of what we do is share it with the scientists and the science community, and as a public asset, share it with the world. Now, so the challenge for our group is for any particular mission to take about 100 mission scientists for example, on Curiosity, there's actually 10 separate instruments. They're located in 7 countries, and in over the course of 8 hours, have to develop a single plan. You can see here that they're located in quite a few different places. And by the way, Curiosity is, I think, a pretty famous spacecraft these days, but our group actually manages the communication and planning for 16 different space missions. And there are 4 in preparation. And we continue to get data to this day from spacecraft like Voyager. It's a very exciting environment. However, as you can imagine, with this age of robotic exploration, I think the challenges that we face as roboticists, people who are interested in other planets and explorers, and people who are interested in human interfaces are actually significant and different than they were when we were during the Apollo age. And so what I wanted to talk about is to bring these differences to the foreground and describe what I think are the most important challenges that we face as a community, and of course look for input and insight into ways to solve these problems. I think the number one problem is what's going on. So we know we have a robot on Mars, but where is it? And in what state is it? And each instrument, where are they located? Well, we know where we think they're located, but in order to do precise measurement, we really need to know the difference between our expected plan and what the real plan is. We need to know, we get tons of data about all of the different sensors, what the temperature is, what the weather conditions are, what the composition of a particular set of minerals are. And we could stitch all of this into a very detailed picture of a landscape, and then we still have this very complicated representation problem of how can we set forward a plan for what we want the robot to do. And as the distance to the robot gets further and further, it becomes more and more important that we can express that in a high-level language. So while we might tell Curiosity, go over there, 10 meters, when we start to explore the outer planets, we're going to need to have the ability to send them a plan that would survive for weeks at a time, because the time delay is so significant. And so both expressing the plan and what inferences the robot is going to make based on our expression of the plan is, I think, one of the hardest problems. So we can sort of encapsulate this as visualization, but I think it's quite a few more things than just that. When we do want a robot to go somewhere, there are a lot of ways that this can be expressed, and I think one of the hardest problems for especially robots that we're looking towards the future to do things like explore asteroids, expressing the high-level objectives of a motion plan in a very natural way is actually a challenging problem. And so we can tell the robot to increment its motion in millimeters, but if we really wanted to say, go over and touch that rock, how do we use that language How can we express that in a way to the robot that's efficient for us as, you know, robot essentially pilots and explorers? And how do we do it in a way that we can validate it? The next two problems are really robotics problems. One is about recalibrating plans and sensor data. So anybody who's ever tried to program a robot knows that there's inevitably a difference between what you want to happen and what really happens. And when we're having robots explore autonomously, one of the things that is challenging is to constantly have the robot reassess what its state is compared to what you originally instructed it to do. And then, I mean, I think probably the hardest plan is when the robot itself is enacting a plan. It's, you know, an autonomous action, how it can really self-monitor and make sure that it's safe. So at this point, I will hand the platform over to my colleague, Mark, who's going to talk a little bit about some of the current missions.
So first I'll talk a little bit about the fourth challenge that Scott was just talking about, how to develop autonomy and to be able to calibrate the system that's executing the autonomy and validate the autonomous algorithms to see if they really meet their expectations. And to do this, I'll put us in the context of one prototype mission of exploration that's preparing us to visit a world that we have not yet visited with a robotics presence for a lengthy period of time anyway. So if we all wish that we had a time machine that could take us into the future or into the past, and the mission that we're trying to capture in this instance is to be able to travel back to a world that looks like the Earth looked like 3 billion years ago, when the atmosphere was not nitrogen and oxygen and carbon dioxide, but had more methane and had really a mix of chemicals. It was not as conducive to life as we have today on our planet. And we, instead of a time machine, we have been fortunate enough to learn that there is a world that is like this now, that is sort of a snapshot of 3 billion years ago Earth, that we can go and visit. If we were to go there, if we weren't a methane breather like this fellow, we wouldn't want to get out of our environment suit. And so it's necessary to visit this world with a robotic mission. And this world is Titan. The moon of Saturn that we've only just barely begun to visit. We can fly by it with Cassini, which is still in operation now, and observe things that are interesting, like the glint at the North Pole, which is the glint off of a lake that's there. To most outward appearances of an orbiter flying by with a camera, this is a world not unlike Venus, where there's a greenhouse layer that you can't penetrate with visible light. You have to look at it with radar in order to map the surface. But we want to learn more about it nonetheless, and so beyond the radar, what can we do next? Well, we dropped a lander called Huygens, which was a collaboration between the French Space Agency and NASA some time ago, to one specific spot chosen more or less at random, and discovered a lot of really interesting things about this world. Although there is a greenhouse layer, the winds, compared to what were expected by scientists, were actually a lot less in their velocity and strength. And the surface, while solid and while the atmosphere contains a lot of methane, A lot of these rocks are composed of water ice, which was a genuine surprise to many. And so that has some very interesting implications. So we want to go back and we want to learn more, and we want to do more than simply drop a lander in one spot and see only out to the horizon of what there is. So how can we do that? Well, since imaging with orbiters is a challenge, it just so happens, due to learning from the Huygens lander, that the greenhouse layer only goes so far down, and after you get down below about 10 kilometers, so through the atmosphere, it's clear as far as the eye can see. And so if we could float an airship over an extended mission and really map the surface in visible light as well as radar and other techniques, then we can start focusing pinpoint surface missions. And so as a platform to prove out the autonomy that you'd need to support an extended mission to Saturn, where the one-way light time is about 8 hours, and communication bandwidth is very, very limited and very, very expensive, use an aerial platform such as the JPL Aerobot in order to conduct a mapping mission. But since it's out of touch for so long and may need to go weeks at a time without any direct communication from Earth, it really needs a great deal of autonomy to be able to affect its self-localization and awareness of its environment in a GPS-denied environment like Titan. And so the autonomy engineers who were creating the onboard software are very interested in being able to validate how well is this autonomy that they're developing performing according to expectations, where is it going wrong, where do we need to deal with unexpected variables that we haven't accounted for yet. And so they use all the sensors, and we have a representation of state as we monitor the performance. And we need to be able to, in richer and richer ways, add additional layers of being able to autonomously monitor the platform's own performance and make adjustments. And so one means that we have to do that, that we currently use, is to use mapping and 3D visualization techniques to both interactively specify this wide blue track, which is the intended path of the airship, and be able to map its progress over time. And you're getting feedback about what the cameras that are looking down through the bottom of the airship that are doing the ego motion, tracking the position of the airship using image-based localization techniques, are seeing. And you're getting insight into things like, well, as the robot is trying to navigate this path, the wind is actually having a significant effect on its trajectory. You want to go directly along the path, but you're having to fight the wind at the same time. And so if you are in an environment like this where you have external forces that are going to affect the way that you're able to navigate, how do you compensate for that? Do you do something with your mobility system to be able to correct for that, or do you simply plan enough margin into your trajectory so that you're able to tolerate a certain amount of this? And of course, another way to get more insight into the performance of the autonomous navigation is to look at it in 3D. And so we do the same sort of visualization with the intended track and a trail of breadcrumbs that the ship is leaving behind it as it's navigating. And this time we're adding in the carrot. So this is the current goal in real time of the autonomy that the airship is trying to go after. And so this is something that adds another layer of insight for the author of the algorithm of the autonomous path planner to really understand what it is that you're asking the robot to do and how it's actually performing in real time relative to that. It's a nice video. Often I get reactions from this video saying, well, does the ship ever get the carrot? And unfortunately, no, the ship doesn't actually get the carrot, but so many people want to see it get the carrot that I'm thinking about adding that capability in another version of the software to have it actually ultimately get the carrot and maybe level up or do something fun like that that's rewarding to see.
Does it only know the carrot or does it know the whole path?
It only knows the carrot, which is, you know, one characteristic or limitation of this algorithm. And so, you know, depending on what you take away from a visualization like this, you might, you know, naturally say, well, should we be more refined in our specification of its goals than a simple point in real time that it's going after? Maybe it needs more history, maybe it needs more future specification or additional higher level.
It's overshooting a little bit sometimes, but it's a little hard to say because you don't have a good way to visualize the wind here. You have no way to visualize the wind.
Right. So actually being able to visualize the wind is very challenging. A few people have done good jobs with that, visualizing the wind and sensing the wind. And the wind, you know, changes as a function of space and as a function of altitude as well. So windsocks can be helpful, but then you have this whole, you know, volumetric spatiotemporal visualization problem when it comes to doing wind. So is this?
Was there no Mars visualization?
Well, the next thing is athlete. So.
Okay. Thanks. Mm-hmm. So another one of the challenges of expressing motion plans in terms of high-level objectives becomes more complicated when the actual platform itself becomes more complicated, more multi-purposed, and less anthropomorphic. And so this is the Athlete rover. It's a robot that's been designed for multiple mission purposes. You can see that here it's very nimble. It's a fast time simulation of the robot getting off a lunar lander and then some embellishment allowing it to dance by using a little bit of just camera trickery. But the actual motion of getting off the lander is for real. But it can bust a move. So you can see how, you know, one of the things it might be designed for is getting off of a lander and then being able to then explore the surface. And similarly, it's carrying a very uncomfortable little compartment in which astronauts could conceivably be. The robot also has a variety of capabilities that here each wheel actually has a tool joint, and the motor for the wheel actually drives the tool as well. And you can see here the robot autonomously picking up something heavy and putting it down. So now this robot is designed for exploration, and here on simulated lunar or Martian surfaces. However, it's also quite a sophisticated robotic system in that while it's a hexapod robot here, it is designed so that it can be daisy chained together to carry a bigger payload and a more sophisticated payload while keeping the deck level. And then similarly, when it's time for exploration or higher risk missions, you can see that the robot is actually two tripod robots that can assemble themselves. So when you think about motion planning or describing a plan for a robot with this kind of agility, even on a flat surface can be challenging. But within the robot's mission purview is also asteroid capture and exploration and mining. And so if you can imagine a surface like this, which is certainly not very planar, and you know, has a microgravity environment of about a hundredth of an Earth gravity, which is the kind of environment where just flexing your shins could sort of put you in orbit, the expressing of a plan becomes a lot more different of a situation. And these are the two biggest asteroids in the Decoupier Belt. And you can see they're also, one seems very solid, whereas this one seems very loose and granular. So our understanding of actually what material we'd be landing on is also highly unknown. And this is just not a future scenario, but to give you perspective of the size and scale of what we'd be talking about orbiting around and landing on. So one of the things that we've been working with is a desktop virtual reality system called ZSpace. It basically uses passive tracking and, passive stereo vision, a passive tracking of your head with two infrared detectors at the top. And one of the, here's a video of how we've developed a system to be able to use the stylus to actually control operations on the robot, where you can see that if we wanted to, for example, have a much more natural way to command, tell the robot what to do, we could use the stylus as basically an orthogonal to one of the end effectors, build a dynamic reachability map, and effectively tell the robot drill in this particular location. And so instead of needing to express all of the motion command, we'd really use an inverse kinematics. The guys had fun making this video. And so by, you know, basically telling the end effector where to go and then calculating through inverse kinematics all of the motion, this is one of the ways in which we've simplified the actual motion planning for any individual limb. But the problem still remains of multiple limbs or a very complicated surface in microgravity. Let's see what else we have here. This is, I'm not sure if this is a video or just a still. Yeah. But also, we built a system where, for example, in imagining trajectory monitoring, one of the other challenges that we have is to plot an ideal path to landing. You essentially have the problem of mapping a path through three space. And along that path, your orbital dynamics might change because, one, you're going to get a more and more detailed map of an object that we've never approached before. Two, we're going to learn more and more about the surface itself that we might have chosen as a landing area. And also, we're going to learn more about the gravitational forces because it might be quite uneven. And so here, we're actually using a surface that we've mounted slightly upright to create a 3D environment that would allow the user to essentially pinch and drag and draw a 3D trajectory, and then at each point be able to plan and tell the robot replan. And so you can see up at the top is the ability that each one of those buttons represents a branch in what to do if this happens. And so we can create a conditional planning structure for the robot in terms of what to do if this spot doesn't look good. Show you some other scenarios. In terms of recalibrating sensor data, another one of the robots that that gives us a very different set of challenges is the Robonaut, And Robonaut is on board the International Space Station and is a very dexterous anthropomorphic robot. And Robonaut is designed to be able to support astronaut work in space, or possibly replace astronaut in space and remind them to stay fit, which is really important in space. So you can see it's a dexterous robot, and also, you know, potentially one that we'd want for repair of various external parts of the space station. One of the things about spacewalks is that they have a lot more danger than just operating under normal circumstances. The astronaut is exposed to a lot more radiation, but even just preparing for a spacewalk requires 4 hours. And so having a very dexterous robot that would potentially serve as a repair robot is a real benefit. But it's also one that, if we'd imagine it needing to be commanded for very subtle gestures like this, so here you can see it following a script, but yet being able to do very delicate maneuvers. If this robot would be, say, teleoperated to do other various chores or repairs, it's something that, I mean, you know, sort of $10 million mailman here. But you can see, you know, these are very precise maneuvers. So the idea, one of the challenges that I think becomes more clear with this robot is this is a sort of behind the scenes shot. So whenever you see the astronauts on the International Space Station, they show you the clean side. But like any real house, there's a place where really things get swept under the rug. And this is actually what I was shocked to learn that it really looks like on the inside. That it's pretty hazardous. There are wires everywhere and displays everywhere. And here you can see the robot mounted in a location where it would be able to, for example, support repair tasks. And what you'd also have is these wires would be moving in a null gravity environment, and precision specification of how to accomplish a task, like a repair or switching wires, can be expressed at a variety of levels of abstraction. And, you know, one being motion by motion, another being just move this wire from there, and then telling it, allowing the onboard autonomy to take over. So one of the things that we were working on here is using actually two connects that are mounted above to map an individual's hand and then map them to a simulation of the Robonaut. And you could see that the individual was grabbing a drill in the simulated 3D space here. And this kind of higher level control is something that, when you can express an objective, we found to be just a lot more natural of a way to command the robot. And of course, in this environment, we don't actually have stereoscopic simulation. And I think this is one of the things we learned, is that that's just critical to being able to operate within a 3D environment. So going back to Mars and Martian telemetry, I'll hand it back to Mark. This is something that he loves to spend time on and has really been in charge of the development of.
All right, thanks, Scott. So, on a mission like Curiosity or Spirit and Opportunity that came before, and Opportunity that's still going on actually, every day is like a new mission for the science and engineering teams that collaborate to plan the activities of these rovers every day. When we drive to a new location, it's like we're starting over again, and we have to reboot our understanding of, well, where, not only where is the robot, but what are all of the targets of opportunity that we now have? And oh, by the way, you have about half an hour to figure that out, because if you don't, if you're not able to express cogent proposals for activities for what the spacecraft is going to do within the first 2 hours of the day, then you'll miss the boat, and someone else will, or nothing will get done that day, which is not what anyone wants. And so the visualization challenge here is to bring as immediate an understanding to a broad segment of this community, as broad as possible, immediately. And so one of the most effective ways to do that, that really spans a multi-generational community of scientists and engineers, is to take a panoramic photo of everything and present that to them as the environment. And we supplement this with individual image views and maps and 3D visualization. But really, for many of these folks, just being able to see your world in 360 all on the screen at once is very, very powerful, and has a low barrier of entry for people to be able to interact with it, because when they want to start building up a lexicon of, let's start talking about specific places that are interesting today, that we want to debate the relative importance of, then simply being able to drop place marks on the terrain and give them familiar names that people can discuss is very important. And so just a click and name targeting system, calling things, you know, naming things according to a theme for the day, like Southern Shore, mullet, oyster, moray eel. These indicate you know, potentially interesting locations that have been identified by some of the scientists. And so we give them a forum to kind of whiteboard these all together in a collaborative fashion. So as one person names something, that name is immediately transmitted to all of the other scientists in the community, and they start to then be able to discuss very naturally the relative importance of one location versus the other. You have a question?
I just wanted to clarify. I'm assuming they're not all co-located, right? Or the scientists aren't, or they are?
We're enjoying a great deal of co-location right now with Curiosity, but it's very brief. It only lasts about the first 90 days of the mission, and that's about to expire. Opportunity Rover has been going over 8 years with everyone geographically distributed, not just around our country, but in Spain, Russia, Canada, other places, Germany. Many of the principal investigators of the instruments and the science payload on these assets are multinational. So we have the need to bring in a global community and to give them all, you know, a fair and equal opportunity to be able to understand all of the potential targets of opportunity that we have in front of us to talk about and plan for in just the next couple of hours. And so so this is sort of the forum that we use to establish that. And then once there's a common lexicon, once people are able to talk about these things effectively, we begin to see proposals for important science observations that need to happen in order to learn more about the surroundings or in order to accomplish the longer range goals of the mission. And they start off at a high level. So take a higher resolution, multi-spectral mosaic of that area there in the center might be one. And the next one from another science theme group might be do a multi-spectral analysis of the target over there on the right called Minnow. That's going to teach us more about the chemistry, whereas the former might teach us more about the geology. And then there's also the longer term goal of the mission, where in this case we might be, you know, seeking to learn as much about this bedrock outcrop in this crater that we're currently looking at. There's an even bigger one that's 12 months away, and if we don't keep driving, we're never going to get there. And so there's constant pressure to be able to support in in a fair way both the immediate needs to do science of where we are on these targets that are right in front of us, and we're probably never going to come back to them and see them again. Once we're gone, we're gone, and this is our only shot. And also, you know, trying to move on to make sure that we hit all of the longer term goals that we have as well before the spacecraft mission is finished. Yes?
Do you directly observe the distances here through some ranging? I mean, I look at this and it seems like I couldn't guess like how far away it is.
Yes, and so behind this visualization, typically what we do is we use stereoscopic imagery to make a 3D terrain mesh of all of the targets that are visible. And so when you simply click and place an icon on a location, there's 3D information about its location and surface orientation that's available behind the scenes as well. And we just tie all that in automatically so that when we have to take these high-level goals and give it to the roboticist who needs that 3D information to say, I need you to take the end effector of this robotic arm and place it along this surface normal vector 2 centimeters from this specific 3D target, which is the level of detail that they need, that they get that. But at the higher level for the science team who are simply debating something more scientifically interesting versus less, then they don't have to necessarily worry about that.
So that's derived by images alone?
With these rovers, yes. They have, depending on the spacecraft, you might have LIDAR systems that can give you the same sort of information if it's an orbiter that's capable of sustaining an instrument with those kinds of power requirements. But on the rovers, there's typically not enough power for things like active laser rangefinders or LIDARs, at least not yet. And so most of the ranging is done through the stereoscopic method.
What's the resolution of that camera?
So for the stereoscopic cameras, the resolution they're basically one megapixel CCDs. On Curiosity, they can range effectively out to a distance of about 40 to 50 meters from the rover. And of course, it gets more sparse the farther that you go out. On MER with the pan cams, they are even higher resolution, and so they can see out to even 100 meters away. But it's very narrow focus, and so you can get very high resolution, small patches of data in key locations. And typically, that's about all that you have time for before you plan a drive that's going to take you over in that direction. And so you have sparse pockets of very high resolution information and a broader collection of lower resolution imagery, but you have it, it's very dense, and you can use that more effectively to make decisions about different ways to go. And so the science teams with these competing goals will debate and reprioritize their science goals so that they try to achieve the highest priority things first. And all the time that they're doing that, they're getting support from the engineering teams who are trying to look at, do we actually have enough spacecraft resources to support all the things that you want to do today? The answer very frequently is no, because their goals are very ambitious and often won't fit into the resources of a single day. And so we've found out for this particular case that we are broken on time. We're using over 100% of our time capacity for the day. There's just not enough time during this particular day to do everything that they want to do. And so they have to make a decision. They have to either reduce the fidelity of one of their science observations so that it will take less time, or they have to defer it to a later day and hope that they're going to stick around in this place long enough to be able to do that before they drive off. That's right, yeah. So yeah, the Martian day or Sol. So 24 hours plus about 39 minutes. But for most of these observations, these imaging observations, or even things like the laser spectrometry that's done with Curiosity require either sunlight to be able to take a picture, or the sun to be up so that the temperature is high enough so that the instrument can be run within its temperature constraints, because you can't run it when it's too cold. You either have to spend power to heat it up, or you have to wait until the sun naturally heats it up for you. And so it's time to make a hard choice, because we don't have enough time to do everything that we need to do. So the decision is made to defer one of the observations until now. We're now fitting within our resource budget. And then, so from here, the high-level plan is refined to a point where it looks achievable with the support of the engineering team to help assess that, and then the engineering team will take the high-level goals and really create a command sequence or a program that the spacecraft is able to execute. And the process of creating the command sequences is very much like a programming task. The tools that we use to do it look very much like IDEs. So you see something that looks like Visual Studio or some other IDE where you're creating a sequenced list of commands and subroutines that the master flow of control calls to execute the subroutines. And they do the things like turn on the heaters and then power on the camera and then take the image and then power off the camera and then do all of the housekeeping that's needed in order to implement these high-level goals, like take a 10 by 3 color 13 filter mosaic of this particular area. And so the engineering team is tasked with doing those work. And as an engineer on the Curiosity mission and the Spirit and Opportunity missions, I get the opportunity to be able to be among the first to be able to see the images that come down when they arrive. Those missions are also very good about being able to distribute those images instantly when they hit the ground, and so you guys get to follow along with us, you know, minutes after the data arrive for us to look at. You guys get all the raw images to take a look at as well, and so really it's really cool to be able to share these experiences with everyone around the world. But since we're there every day and involved in it, we really enjoy the surprises that we get, like on Opportunity mission, a few days after we landed, we noticed this little guy and wondered what in the world that it was. Was this something that was there on Mars, or was this maybe something that we brought with us? It kind of looked like a bunny. And so we took more pictures of it, and he's like, hey, that's looking more and more like a bunny. It's got two eyes and little ears, and we took multi-filter color imagery of it and in an attempt to learn more about it. And we found that if you blink the images between the little eyes, it kind of looks like it's winking at you, and the ear is moving a little bit. We're like, this is curiouser and curiouser. And the scientists, meanwhile, are going wild about this bedrock outcrop that's got all these cool morphologies that they've never seen before on Mars, and oh my gosh, isn't this wonderful? And the engineers are like, have you seen this bunny? And they're like, yeah, that's nice. Go away. But nonetheless, we were further intrigued when we took a picture of it again a day later to learn yet more about it, and it disappeared. It was gone. And we're like, okay, this is definitely something that we need to learn more about. And so we managed to find it a few days later. It was it had blown under the lander where the rover had bounced to a halt. And we aimed a spectrometer at it and discovered that, yeah, that's a shred of airbag material that fell off as it bounced to a halt in the crater that we got there. But it was an amusing diversion for us at the time. And I had a real sense of deja vu when last week with Curiosity, we were scooping up our first material from this rock nest region that we've driven to. This is the scoop on the robotic arm that's going to collect samples that we're going to use in the chemistry labs that are in the payload of this rover that we didn't have on MER. And down there at the bottom, there's a small little bright thing that one of my colleagues saw and zoomed in on it and said, oh, what is that? I'm like, I'm not sure what that is. Pretty soon it went viral among the engineering team, and they were like, oh, well, we're not sure if that might be something that was on the arm or not. We really need to kind of figure out what that is so that we can assure that it's going to be safety. Yeah. And so we immediately dropped everything and started taking lots of pictures of it and discovered that this is just a piece of debris, probably some of the plastic that was used externally to wrap some of the wiring that engages the robotic arm instruments. But it was important to learn what this was because as we're scooping up the material, we want to make sure that we're getting only Martian material and no Earth material mixed in there that's going to influence any results that we hope to learn.
Figured out a way to litter interplanetary.
Yeah. How much stuff is this shedding? It's like it's driving along, just like shedding all this stuff.
Right. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, so we're keeping a very close eye on that now. But also in this region, there are some really interesting heterogeneous materials that are from Mars. There's a little clod of dirt there in the center upper area, with some little bright white speck-sized places in it that you can see. And we didn't bring that with us. That is generally like heterogeneous material that is as yet unknown composition. And so this is it's good that this shedding business has put us in an even higher state of alertness because it's really helping us to focus and identify all of the unexpected and interesting things that we're seeing in the newest images that are coming down so that we can make the most of the opportunities that we have. And this is just a little map showing our progress so far over about the first 60 sols of this mission. The area on the right is where we are now, and we're headed along that green line to this destination where it's an interesting crossroads between three geological units. We have one geological unit, which is most of the center on the right, this kind of brown in color. And then on the upper right corner, we have another geological unit that's brighter. And in the lower right corner, we have another geological unit that's a little bit darker. And so geologically, we want to study what are the differences between these regions at this crossroads, and how does that fit into the larger regional picture of the evolution of this region as we've come to see it so far. And so to be able to bring this picture in focus for all of our geographically distributed contributors on a daily basis, we use tools like these maps that dynamically load an enormous, hundreds of kilometers of Mars regions like this at Gusev Crater for Spirit that we're seeing here, where we can zoom in and see not only the broader regional context, geologically speaking, but be able to zoom in to the rover scale and be able to mix in data that it takes in situ and overlay its traverse path and all of its locations that it's visited and all of the 3D information that we get from its stereo image collection so that we can zoom all the way down from kilometers all the way down to centimeters and put everything into its geological scale at multiple resolutions. And so this is an orbiter image. And so for planning our missions, even on a daily basis, we tie everything back from the rover data to the satellite data, which gives us a broader regional context, which is really useful for the geologists and the long-term planners to be able to see if you planned to go 100 meters, did you actually go 100 meters? Did you actually not go 100 meters but go only 90 meters? Or did you go further than you thought? And what effect is that going to have on what we're going to do today by way of compensation if you didn't get to exactly where you expected to go? Sure.
Yeah, thinking long-term, announcements this last week of some new planets discovered, one with four suns and another by our neighbor off of Centauri. So how will this influence what we aim for in the century?
So it's going to be an interesting challenge to try to extend a lot of the techniques that we're using for a planetary neighbor that's relatively close to us to one that is going to be in Alpha Centauri. Where we're able to plan a complex set of science observations to run tactically on Mars when it's only about 20 minutes light time away every day, when you go only as far as Saturn, to say nothing of Alpha Centauri, you have to plan a little bit farther in advance because your bandwidth is a lot more expensive and a lot more limited, and the autonomy that you need therefore to be able to keep the spacecraft safe while you're waiting for your next opportunity to to be able to communicate with it, those needs are higher as well. And so to cover these greater and greater distances, we need to be able to do more higher level goal specification, higher level contextual awareness for people to be able to understand after, you know, if you only see brief glimpses that are very that are separated very far in time. So if you're only visiting your spacecraft about once a month, it's very easy to, you know, lose touch with, well, where was it again the last time that I checked in on this mission? And so being able to kind of, you know, to refresh your mental cache of, oh yes, now based on the last context, I see now this new information and how it ties together with the other information that I've seen before. And so that is a grand challenge for us to pursue.
I have a feeling we'll be pretty busy exploring our own solar system for a long time. There's a lot to discover.
Yeah. And there's certainly a lot to discover in the solar system, and after we've exhausted all of those, which will take longer than my lifetime, I'm encouraged to see that there's going to be lots of other, you know, hundreds of other already known mysteries and other planets, exoplanets that we find with our Planet Finder missions left for people to follow me to pursue, and that'll be even more exciting for them. So in order to provide this immediate contextual awareness for all of our partners, we've extended our data processing to a parallel cloud-based system for processing and distribution. And so in order to make sure that the latency to get to this data is relatively short no matter where you are in the world, and in order to make sure that it's presented for our collaborators as soon as possible, basically as soon as the bits from space come through the DSN to us, we immediately put it on the cloud and we immediately start doing all of our advanced product and visualization generation, transforming the raw products into stereo maps, into 3D terrain and maps and mosaics and all of that. We do it all in parallel and we do it all in the cloud, and we stage all that data also on the cloud, geographically distributed, so that everybody has equivalent performance despite where they may be, or independent of where they may be working from. And so we'll take not just the raw data, but we have a lot of metadata from the spacecraft itself, where it is, where its orientation is, other related metadata information that we can put into and build a search index, and we can tile it up so that we can have a tiled map with different levels of detail. Similar processing for taking pairs of imagery and creating the 3D meshes, which we also tile up. And then one of our most computationally challenging tasks to do quickly is to build up large mosaics of imagery. So take, you know, thousands of images and warp them together into one cylindrical panorama 360. In order to do that in parallel, we divide it up into stripe sections and then merge them together and create different levels of detail and tile those up for our tiled image viewer. And we also do that for the satellite imagery as well, so that it can all be feeding into the visualization I was showing you a few slides ago. So this is one of our parallelization strategies where you take the entire image, maybe many tens of gigapixels in size, and divide it up into stripes, give every stripe to a processor, tile them up, and then produce a lower level of detail from that by combining two stripes and tile that up and use this pyramid technique to bring all of that together. And so that was, I think, all that we had. And just wanted to throw this slide in there to show off our institution itself, which is in a very nice place, right next to a forest and mountains, and a very nice place to visit. I'd like to encourage all of you guys to come and pay us a visit whenever you have the opportunity. It's a fun place to see all the robotic work that's going on there, both in support of the rovers and the other systems like the Robonaut and Athlete that Scott was showing earlier. So thank you very much, and love to entertain any questions that you guys have at this time.
Sure. Earlier you talked about on Titan lack of GPS. How much for these things are you using celestial navigation? I guess you'd have some, and higher up in the atmosphere you'd have very good view of all the stars, especially also on asteroids.
So celestial navigation is very much used for the spacecraft that are in space, but even on Mars, the atmospheric distortion is significant enough that observing stars is very challenging. And so to do things like to refine the rover's knowledge of its orientation, we're limited to being able to do things like observe the sun, which is the only star, I'm sorry to say, that's bright enough for us to be able to see through the Martian atmosphere with any real reliability. We are able to do some observations of things like the moons of Mars, Phobos and Deimos. If we take a picture of them at night when there's not a lot of ambient illumination, we can see something that's that bright that's basically reflecting the illumination from the sun down to us. But the stars themselves, after we're on the surface, are not available for our cameras to observe, which would be terrific. But
I guess a blimp on Titan would have a much richer set of objects to look at.
So the blimp on Titan actually would also be dwarfed by the illumination from Saturn itself, and wouldn't be able to, if it was below the greenhouse layer, it would have the same problem that we have when we're trying to look down through the greenhouse layer from orbit. And so the localization problem then, I think, becomes what can we do by observing the landmarks beneath us rather than the stars above us. And so that seems like the most promising direction to go. Using LIDAR and image-based differencing techniques, image-based localization techniques to accomplish that in lieu of a GPS capability. Do you have a question?
Is there any, you mentioned processing of stereo images, is there any processing that's done sort of client-side on the rover, or there's no power for sensing and gathering sensor data and processing it and being able to plan locally?
Oh yes, there's a great deal of processing that happens on board on the rovers, particularly on Spirit and Opportunity. We're kind of graduating Curiosity, the newest rover, putting us through its paces before we are able to fully trust its autonomy to do all the things that Opportunity has done. But Opportunity has begun by using a simple path planning algorithm by taking stereo maps and looking for obstacles and moving toward goals. Kind of a plan, sense, act, basic robotic autonomy with obstacle avoidance pipeline, to being able to do richer and richer autonomy things. So it's able to use visual odometry to refine its localization, to do better than simply counting wheel rotations and being affected by slipping around on the soil without having any way to compensate for that. It's able to be able to monitor its own localization very accurately now using visual odometry. And it's also able to extend those techniques to be able to do higher level path planning, not only for driving, but also for placing the robotic arm. And so now from 10 meters away, we can say, that rock over there on that point, drive over there and put the spectrometer on the end of the arm down on that. And it can execute that autonomously as well. It's also able to identify unusual features in images as potential science targets as well. So it has enough autonomy so that in the extra time that it has at the end of the day after a drive, it can take some pictures and it can seek to identify unusual things, things that are different than things that have been seen before. So based on a machine learning technique, it's able to assimilate features in the images that it can take post-drive and say, seen this before, maybe haven't seen that before, and so maybe that's something to take a higher resolution of predictably and prioritize that in the downlink and highlight that to the science team and say, hey, you might want to look at that, because these things seem unusual. Yeah. So number of things.
And in Spirit and Opportunity, for example, they developed a dust devil detector, which became one of these interesting, you know, real image difference visual objects, but also something that was both easy to detect and something that was a real object of interest. And so you could also tell the, allow the robot to focus more of its own sensor and memory capacity on these particular images. But one thing that I was, I think, both that I was surprised to learn is that when the when a rover like Curiosity lands, the JPL basically assumes nothing works, right? Like everything, we have no evidence of any arm, of any movement, of any sensor. And so, you know, we land on Mars and the world is watching, and then for about 5 days, nothing happens. And basically they're just, you know, warming up the components and making sure all the instruments work. And, you know, here we are 60 days in, and you know, it was, Curiosity was built to be a chemist, right? Basically a chemistry robot, and yet it's taken us 60 days to take it, to actually risk taking a sample. But gradually that comfort level will grow more and more. And what I find also fascinating is that we can reprogram Curiosity. And as there's more and more confidence that we can send control sets and instruction sets that allow the robot to have higher degrees of autonomy and tolerance for risk as it becomes more acceptable.
Right.
So how much of the day does a robot self-test? So it wakes up in, mm-hmm. Flying drones, that's where we spend like 30% was just self-testing all the components.
Yeah.
On the aircraft and stuff like that. So how much do you spend in the Curiosity?
In the morning, maybe an hour, is it?
So most of the testing is in collaboration with the engineering team itself, right? Like what Scott was just saying, when you don't know if the chemistry lab is going to work, then you start with a simple test and then a little more ambitious test, and then moving through to extend its capability to the best that you can achieve. And so, like in the early phase of the mission, like a lot of the days are scripted and devoted to that kind of testing. And more as we're moving into the latter phases of this mission, you have unscripted days where you know where all of your reliability is that you can build on, and you can increase your ambition level, and you can do more audacious things and really do more science than you could before. It's not just the pre-scripted things that you know you need to do. You know you need to do your calisthenics and you need to do your warm-up so that you can go and you can run this marathon, yeah. Which is what we're preparing to do right now. And so, there will be, we're looking forward to the days when, you know, 6 to 8 to even 10 hours of the day, it's all ambition, it's all run. And, so that in 12 months we're going to get to that spectacular destination that we're all hoping to get to the south of our current location.
Yeah.
What's the next big project, robot project, you guys see coming up?
Well, I think there's quite a few that are happening in parallel. The missions that we're most involved in are the Athlete and the Robonaut. Robonaut is actually like currently on the International Space Station, and so it's being space proven. The Athlete is being explored as a real multi-mission capability robot. There are, I mean, whole varieties of just really very, very out there exploratory missions, ones that are 10% success rate, where they're going to, let's just try these crazy ideas and see if they work. I think we deal with the robots that there's already been about a decade of work on Athlete. So I, you know, but there's a huge number and people are betting on totally different approaches to, for example, going to Europa, and then what would it take to get through the ice layer? And so there's you know, an entire robotics team dedicated to thinking about how to thaw and then autonomously search through what they're imagining to be an ocean. And you know, so it's a both a totally different way to navigate, a huge set of challenges that are totally different. But I would roughly guessing 60 different projects.
Yeah, NASA doesn't put all its eggs in one basket either. Like simultaneously, we're exploring making better autonomy to be able to support a variety of missions, like what if we want to fly an airship at Titan versus, well, what if we want to support a boat at Titan that's flying around, that's floating around on that lake that we can observe that's there at the North Pole? Maybe that would be the kind of surface mission we want to do a survey of that environment. And so what kind of autonomy do you need there? Or if we want to do even more at Mars, then what kind of systems do we need to support a sample return mission, which would be very, very exciting. It's something that is very, very challenging, has been looked at for a number of years. And ultimately, it's going to be done. It's just a matter of when. It's just a matter of when all the resources and everything come together at the right place at the right time. But we'll have a sample return mission from Mars one day. We'll have a sample return mission from the Moon pretty soon if things continue going that way.
Yeah.
And so that's another really, really lucrative, really great set of robotic missions that we have to look forward to.
I think probably the other main objective in our group is through gathering all of this data that we have available in these smaller channels to allow scientists the ability to, for example, take a walk on Mars, and so be able to really experience it in a different way that's more similar to the way that they generate their hypotheses now, so that geologists don't like look at a television of California and think about hypotheses about it. They go there and they look at the layers, and so to allow them the ability to explore it in a more first-person way is also, I think, one of the challenges that our group is looking into, and more of a human interface is an experiential challenge than one of robotics. But I think we really work at the overlap. Yeah, Andy, please.
Can you join us for lunch? Because given the time, we should get going.
So if you want to join us for lunch, that's what we're doing next over in the cafeteria. But thanks a lot, you guys.
Yeah. Thank you.